Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Thank you all for coming out on such a dreary day. I hope the topic won't make things even drearier. Sometimes it's better to know the truth about things rather than to have illusions. This is a very, very important, serious topic. On behalf of my colleague, Professor Henrik Schatzinger of the Politics and Government Department, myself, Brian Smith, and co-directors, as you know, of the Center for Politics and the People, this is our first event of the semester, and we are delighted that everyone is here. Human trafficking is a modern-day form of slavery, and it's a major global industry in the world that nets, this isn't gross, this is net, over $32 billion a year. Victims include children, teenagers, young men, and men. The victims are subjected to force, fraud, or coercion for the purpose of sexual exploitation or forced labor. And this is an international slavery ring. Approximately 300,000 children are at risk of being sex trafficked just in our country. The average age of entry into this form of slavery is 14. And the youngest victim that has been rescued in the United States was 18 months old. In our own state, human trafficking exists not only in large urban areas like Milwaukee and Madison, but in rural areas, in small towns, in the Fox Valley. The first federal case of human trafficking was prosecuted in Wisconsin just 10 years ago. And 4 days ago, the police in Oshkosh arrested a suspected perpetrator or pimp for engaging in human trafficking in the Fox Valley. Evelyn Galster of Freeland Foundation, with offices in Green Lake, which works on the global issue of human trafficking, especially in Asia, had been invited to participate on the panel this afternoon, but due to health reasons, she was not being able to be part of the presentation. One of the handouts you're receiving, however, explains the work of the Freeland Foundation, which has offices in Green Lake and in Thailand. And you can have more information if you want to follow up. We're also distributing information about the Green Lake Conference Center, which is doing a major conference in the spring on human trafficking. This afternoon, we have with us Sister Celine Gessel of Holy Cross Sisters in Green Bay. Celine is a member of the Sisters of Mercy of the Holy Cross, an international women's order based in Switzerland with a provincial house in Merrill, Wisconsin. She has served as a teacher, a community president, pastoral administrator of the church, spiritual director, retreat leader, and lecturer. She earned her bachelor's degree in music education from Alverno College in Milwaukee, a master's degree in theology from St. John's University in Collegeville, Minnesota, and a doctor of pastoral ministry from St. Mary's Seminary and University in Baltimore. Celine currently works with iHeartWorld, an organization that educates the public and supports the victims of human trafficking in the Fox Valley of Wisconsin. And she will speak to us today with her words, her PowerPoint presentation, and her DVD video about how sex trafficking is actually operating in our area, who the victims are, how are they caught into this net, and what is being done to stop it. Welcome, Sister Celine.
Now, he took my first 10 minutes of what I was going to say, so I can just go right on. But I really want to thank you for letting me come. I brought Sister Kathy Lang with me, and she's going to be around afterwards. I have some DVDs that I have. What?
Recorded from a conference.
Yeah, recorded from a big conference that I had with over 400 people. And so it's a 2-hour long thing, and it will give you more information, and it will give you information about a survivor. And she will be available at the end, and they are $5 a piece. But if you don't have money, students, if you don't have money, just tell Sister Kathy you're poor, and she should give you one free. So, first of all, I would like to give you a definition of human sex trafficking. It's the buying and the selling of people as though they were store-bought merchandise. Men and women and children are lured, as Brian said. They're lured, they're tricked, they're coerced, they're drugged, they're brainwashed and abducted into this industry where they are treated like animals. In fact, the traffickers call them their stable. One of the handouts that you were given has the fact that this is a problem. It's right on the front. And that this is a booming industry. It's been around for a long, long time, but we are realizing that it hasn't been nearly eradicated yet. And our own Pope Francis over in Italy would like to see this completely eradicated from the world by the year 2022. So that's one of my problems that I'm working on, and I'm coming to ask you to help with it. Now, you notice that there are three groups of people that we want to talk about. Why is this not working for me? Okay. And I'll tell you. The first are the buyers. You know, this is a business, and every business has a demand and a supply. Well, these are the demanders. And so these are the people that we want to really get after. However, you need to know who they are first. The buyers of sex, they're sometimes called Johns, and I don't use that word because I'm just afraid that some guy in here is named John, and I would hate to insult that person. So I will call them what they are. They are buyers of sex. And unfortunately, these men are people that most of us know, not as buyers of sex, but as fathers of good families, have wonderful wives or wonderful girlfriend, CEOs of corporations, they're clergy, they are doctors, teachers, policemen, and men who are greatly respected, men right here in the little town of Ripon, men who are greatly respected. They have the money to purchase another human being for their own pleasure, and they're willing to pay big bucks. In fact, one little thing that I would just like to throw in here, if a pimp is able to supply certain buyers with a virgin, with a young girl who's a virgin, they are willing to pay up to $1,000 to have an hour with this young girl. Those men often, I guess they're victims too, because the buyers of sex often fill their minds with pornography. And because that is so accessible on the internet, they can be addicted and subsequently unable to control their own actions. Who are the pimps? Pimps are also called traffickers. They go around looking for victims to sell. They're usually well-dressed. Most of the time, they're between 40 and 50 years old, and they look for young girls that they can control. They work singly or in pairs, and they are found all over. And you know, if you have any drug problems here in Ripon, then you also have a sex trafficking problem. Those things also go hand in hand. And these pimps, you know, they learn how to groom the victims and make them very loved and wanted and pretty and special. And a pimp will take plenty of time to talk to this young person. Most 80% are females, but that doesn't mean that males are not in danger, because they are also on the lookout for males if there is a sex buyer who would like to have a male. They'll drug them, the pimps will, give them alcohol and have sex with them finally after they have sort of convinced them, you know, that they're so special, and they begin trusting the pimp. And then they'll have sex with them, and then they'll say to them, okay, now, you know, I've spent a lot of money on you. I've given you wonderful clothes, I've given you a lot of big gifts. I've taken you out to dinners, and I have to get that money back now. So I'm just going to ask you to do something for me. And of course, very often by that time, the victim is so tuned into this guy who she or he thinks, you know, is their special friend, that they will do anything. And so they will have sex with a number, sometimes up to 35 men in a day. And I can't imagine that. I'm a Catholic sister, so I don't really know what I'm talking about, never having had sex. But I can imagine that you people who are wives, if your husband would ask you 35 times a day, you'd tell him, go get lost. Unless you're very madly, madly in love. Okay, so these are the traffickers. Then we come to the victims. There's no consistent face of a trafficking victim. They can be rich, they can be middle class, they can be poor, they can be as young as 7 years old. And even younger. You heard Brian say that 18 months. I can't quite fathom that. But as young as 7 years old, a lot, 10 years old, but also, as Brian said, usually around 12 to 14 are the ages of the victims that pimps want to get a hold of and control. The pimps don't make a distinction as long as they're making money. And I know because I have seen incidences where a pimp will come in with a car with maybe five or six young women into a truck stop, and he will send them out and he will tell them, don't you dare come back until you have between $800 and $1,000 in your pocket. So you see that this crime is a crime of greed and money. It is not, it has absolutely nothing to do with love. And of course, she has to come back, give the trafficker the money, because he says he will keep it for her, for, you know, he'll keep save it for her, so that someday, probably when they get married, then they'll be using it. Okay, so the victims. There are other victims. You know, sometimes a girl graduates from high school or gets into college, and before she can go out and find a first job, she falls in love, and so she marries. And then children come along, and then all of a sudden one day, her husband says, I don't love you anymore, I want a divorce, and I'm leaving. And this poor woman has no work skills. She knows how to cook, she knows how to take care of children. And you also know that in many of our courts, the spouse gets, ex-spouse gets away with not paying child support. And so here is a young woman, frantic. She needs to keep a roof over the head of her children. She needs to keep clothes on their back, and she needs to keep food on the table. And so she goes out and she says, and she has probably been trafficked at a younger age herself. And she goes out and she says, this is the only way I know to do what I need to do for my family. So when you hear about prostitutes, I hope you will think, or if you see them down on the streets, and I don't doubt that if I would come to Ripa at 3 o'clock in the morning and drive around, I might see young girls walking the streets, waiting for someone to pick them up. And it's happening. It's happening all over in Wisconsin. There are 72 counties in Wisconsin, and every single county has sex trafficking problem. So, and I've talked to a number of the older women, the 18 to 24 to 30-year-olds. And not one of them have said, oh yeah, when I get up in the morning, I say, yeah, it's a good day. I think I'm gonna go out and sell my body today. Never. They feel very, very caught, and they don't know what to do about it. And as I said, the process of supply and demand is very real. And so we need to get rid of the demand, and then there will be no need for a supply. So for so long, we've conducted stings, and the victims, young as they were, 14, 15, 16, were put in jail. The pimps, the traffickers, had their hands slapped. And you know what happened to the buyers of sex? They're not even on the police radar. And for quite a few years, that has happened. And just in the past few years, I think we became a little smarter. And so we are The Catholic Sisters of the State of Wisconsin have asked legislature that if there are any young girls who have a jail record, that that be struck from their record. And that has happened. Wisconsin now has a rule that says no child, person under 17, can be jailed for this purpose. Now I'd like to talk a little bit about the fact that Wisconsin is among the top states in the United States, which has an intense sex trafficking activity. And here we find, again, those are on the back of your first handout. And we want you to take those home and share them with your family, share them with friends, share them with relatives, because we need everybody, first of all, to become aware of what is happening in our country and throughout the entire world. But we, because as I began looking at this tremendous problem, it was too large for me. So I have been doing my research in the state of Wisconsin and primarily among children. And so I have quite a few facts. I call these facts and statistics, but we also have to be careful because this is such an elusive crime that when I first started talking, I said, Wisconsin is the third worst state in the United States. Well, it wasn't too long when I had to trim that down. I said, Wisconsin is the fifth. And now I'm telling you tonight, because we keep getting all kinds of information, because we have more stings, we pull in the traffickers and the buyers of sex. And they finally begin to tell us what's really going on. And so I'm just saying, Wisconsin is still among the top ones. And why is this? Oh, okay, let's talk. I forgot that I had this. If there's a pimp out on your street, and that's why it's not good for you young ladies to be walking from place to place at night, because I'm reasonably sure that eventually, if there aren't now, there is going to be someone around who's going to look at you and say, such beautiful eyes, you are so beautiful. And all you have to do is say, thank you, in that tone of voice, and walk away. He knows he will not be able to control you. So, don't get friendly with these fellows. So where are they? They're on the internet, and we'll talk a little bit more about the internet. They are also in schools. They are in malls, and how many of you have ever heard of the Mall of America? Yeah. The Mall of America is a horrible place. Do you have a mall around here? Well, you have one in Oshkosh. The mall in Green Bay has pimps trotting around looking for victims, and I suspect any mall, even the one in Oshkosh, the one in Appleton certainly, also has them looking. On the streets, in the parks, there's one place up there that I didn't have down, and that is at public libraries. And why would you find pimps at public libraries? It's because all public libraries have quite a few computers, and they can get on the internet. And the internet is so good for so many things, but for producing more crime in sex trafficking, the internet is very horrible. And so is your iPhone. And you know, I've been hearing on the news, we're back to the sexting. God, I don't know why you would want to send out pictures of your naked body. You know, that's going to go into cyberspace, and someday when you grow up and get married and have children, you know, that might be out there yet. And what are the children going to say? Hey, Mom, I saw you. I saw you. I pulled something out of cyberspace, and I saw you. Whew. Okay. So, we can go on. And there, again, we have the average number of times a victim is sold in one day. And because victims are often drugged or given alcohol, their lifespan is about 7 or 8 years at the most. And so if somebody in your family or some friend of yours, if they are missing, if they're not found within 48 hours, most probably they will not be seen again. Perhaps by the grace of God, it could happen, but not really. So let's go to the next one. I told you that the Catholic Sisters in the state of Wisconsin had been working hard. Now, every Catholic church has been given a toolkit. And in that toolkit are a whole line of things. If your church is near a Catholic church, just walk over to them and say, I understand that the sisters in the state of Wisconsin gave you a free toolkit. Could I use the DVD called Chosen to see what it's all about? Or if the church right next door would like to talk to their teenagers, go over and ask St. Catherine's. Father Bob better have it. If he doesn't, let me know. Because they were each given one. Also, what we did last year, we put these posters on transportation buses in Milwaukee, Oshkosh, Green Bay, I think maybe even Fond du Lac. And these were out primarily last year when, just around Thanksgiving time, when we were wanting people to become more aware. And so we also had an electronic billboard up. But these cost a tremendous amount of money, and we couldn't afford that. So, going on then to the next. I told you Wisconsin is among the top ones, and why? Well, there's an active pimp school somewhere in Milwaukee teaching people from all the other states. Guys come over from all the states around our country to learn the art of pimping. And in Milwaukee, there is that place where they learn how to manipulate, coerce, drug, scare, especially children. They have corridors where they can transport. If they see, the police are getting too close, if they see they're too close, they grab their victims and they say, get in the car, we're off. And if you ever looked at a map of Wisconsin, you will notice that both north and south and east and west. We have a tremendous grid of superhighways. And they can have somebody in Michigan or in Minnesota in the matter of a couple hours. Our state is rural, and many people are unaware of what's happening. And I wouldn't call our Wisconsin citizens naive. I would call them a group of kind people who don't tend to think bad things about other people, I guess. And so I think that's why this crime may be happening right in your neighborhood and you don't even know about it. Okay. We're a tourist state, and people who are not at home tend to do a lot of things that they would never do if they were at home. And then fourth, there are sports events, the Packer home games, and I live in Green Bay, and I know what's happening in Green Bay. This is not the fault of the Packers, and I have been accused of giving black eyes to the Packers because I'm saying at Packer home games, a lot of victims are brought in for human sex trafficking. But just a couple weeks ago, I talked to a woman who works at Lambeau Field, and she said she has never seen a Packer home game. And it's because She works in the inside, she's an elevator operator. And she said, all during Packer games, those elevators go up and down and up and down and up and down. And she said, just the other night, two guys came in, oh, maybe about 40 or 45 years old. And she said, so, sirs, what level do you want to go to? And they said, level 4. And then she turned around, and there were 4 young teenage girls coming in also. And she said, and young ladies, where are you planning to go? And they put their heads down and looked at the floor, and one said very quietly, I think to the same floor. So she took them up, but then she was able to call police help to come in. And we know that a lot of trafficking goes on during these games, and we also know that there are some pimps who are caught, and hopefully some buyers of sex. Okay, I think there are a couple more reasons. Oh. Law enforcement does not have an overabundance of officers on the beat. And just a little more than a year ago, the policemen in Chicago and in Milwaukee tightened up, and they put more policemen on full time to just work sex trafficking. And because pimps got nervous about it, they just picked up their operation and they moved it farther north. And I am told by one of the officers from Brown County that Green Bay is now, and it's only an hour and 20 minutes from here, I know, because I just came this afternoon. We are told that lost my thought. Green Bay is a hub for highly intense sex trafficking activity. And that is nothing to be proud of. Okay. All right, I also want to talk to you about the dangers of the internet, of cell phones. You know, the internet and iPhones give anyone of any age access to information, both helping us to eradicate this crime, and also to flaming the crime into a more lucrative activities. Craigslist, Backpage, and Facebook are very, very dangerous. And parents and grandparents, if you have children here, you really need to know what they're looking at. And I know that many of our young people nowadays have their own computers in their own bedrooms. And I'm not sure that's real smart. And parents, you're not snooping if you go in to find out what they've been looking at. Or if you check out their iPhone to see what's been on the iPhone. Backpage was in trouble most of the summer. We, again, the sisters and a good number of other people. We're not the only ones out there. But every time I go and talk to people, I say, get involved. And this is one way you can. Get out there. And because of Backpage, they were fined tremendously. And they said, okay, they had to pay. And they removed what the advertisements, which were very, I don't know, you could tell if you read the advertisement what they were asking for. So now they think they got smarter. They took off their ads, but then they have escort ads and they have a different type, another whole language. But they continue to do the same thing. They put ads out on Facebook and Backpage and Craigslist, and that's how they get a lot of their buyers of sex. Now, pornography is a tremendous, tremendous, tremendous danger, because it causes addiction, which can only be cured through professional help. Online pornography has reached an epidemic of unbelievable proportions. 1 in 5 men, that means 20%, admit to watching pornography while they are at work. And ladies, don't say, oh yeah, those dirty men, because 13% of women do the same thing. Children pornography generates about $3 billion annually. Every second, pornography makes about $3,000. There are searches for over 116,000 child pornography pictures every single day. And you know, how sick can that be? I can't really wrap my mind around that. Sunday is the most popular day to watch pornography. Okay, got it. The revenue, this is interesting. I have a wrong word up there. The revenue from pornography is more than all the professional basketball, football, and baseball franchises combined. That's how lucrative it is. And then we talk about child pornography, which, you know, 116 searches every day. Wow. Okay. Sorry. Yeah. Okay. We are going to be asking you to do something about this. I know some of the students here will probably be writing term papers on this topic, But you people who are out there in the village of Ripon, we want you to be doing something too. Because now that you know, you can't just be silent. And be aware of signs. And I have a lot of, can a few of you people come and help? I have a lot of, you'll pass them out. Are you gonna go down the road? Oh. Thanks. Okay, you can take as many as you need. She'll give you each one, but if you need more before you leave tonight, please stop, because they'll be up here at this table. And if you want to give one to somebody else. And I'm thinking primarily these are good to be aware of in truck stops. I can tell you, if we have time at the end, I will tell you a little bit about Kathy's and my experience at a truck stop. But I'd like to stop right now and show you a DVD that tells you a little bit more about what happens when a victim is stolen.
This woman, we'll call her Sarah. The suffering began when she was kidnapped in her early teens. Forced to engage in stripping and prostitution, Sarah endured horrific physical and mental abuse.
Having gasoline poured on me while they held a match. Being kicked and stomped on, being drugged by my hair. Having 15 guys circle me and stomp me, and I'm in there, stomp me.
As traffickers moved her from city to city, town to town, fear, not shackles, kept Sarah from breaking free.
Fear of my family being harmed, fear of myself being harmed or killed, believing that my traffickers would carry out what they said they would do. Fear of no one believing me. Going to the police was not an option at the time, so I thought I was brainwashed to believe that no one would help me. If anything, it would put me in more danger or even put me in jail.
Sarah's story is tragically typical for many victims of human trafficking, a modern-day form of slavery happening in the U.S., which forces tens of thousands of women, children, and men into brutal conditions for little or no pay. Many are forced into commercial sex. Others end up working in hotels and restaurants as domestic servants, on farms or in sweatshops. Esmeralda, a name we gave her, was just 11 years old when her mother in Guatemala sold her to a Guatemalan man who turned her into his sex slave. Smuggled into the United States, she endured long days of cooking, cleaning, and childcare, and nights of repeated rapes and brutality.
He told me that he paid money for me and that he can do whatever he wants with me. And everyone I was asleep, please give me, like, you know, I was bleeding and everything because we have a carpet and the room. It was blood everywhere.
While traffickers find some victims in the U.S., often their targets, like Esmeralda, come from other parts of the world. Latin America, Africa, the former Soviet Union, and Southeast Asia.
It's important to realize that although people might have been brought here willingly, when they do arrive to the United States, that they're put in positions that they have no idea they would be placed in. They're either forced into prostitution or some type of slave labor. It's important that we treat them as victims and not as criminals.
Jail could be better because, you know, people will feed, they will feed you and they know that you're there. But that house, nobody know that I was there. I was like, down, I do nothing. It's like, I'm not there.
Traffickers rely on brutal tactics, emotional and physical bondage, to enslave their victims.
They told me if somebody asks you if I'm in hospital, just tell them I'm your brother or something. You better tell them. If you say something, I'm going to kill you. That was his home. He used to get a knife and put it in my neck over here, so he was going to kill me.
Traffickers use a variety of methods to keep their victims enslaved. We've seen everything from force, fraud, coercion, ranging from physical beatings and torture to psychological intimidation or threats to their family members back in their home country.
Human trafficking occurs across the U.S. in big cities, small towns, and rural areas. It's unlikely that victims will be found and rescued in significant numbers until the American public gains a much greater awareness of the horror of human trafficking. That's the goal of Rescue and Restore, a major public awareness effort launched by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services to identify and assist the victims of human trafficking.
Since the campaign started, numerous victims have been identified and are now eligible for benefits and services they need in order to restore their lives.
The Rescue and Restore campaign reaches out to people on the front lines, those who have the best chance of coming into contact with victims, like faith-based communities, social service providers, health workers, and law enforcement officers.
Many victims don't come forward because they're afraid or because they don't realize that what's being done to them is wrong. Traffickers can control victims in many different ways, sometimes physically, through beatings, locked doors, or lack of food and sleep, but also psychologically. Psychological trauma, or the stigma or shame from being trafficked, can be so severe that victims aren't able to face the situation, but just hope that someday it will end. Traffickers often use threats against victims or their loved ones back home, including their children. And they convince victims that if they speak with police, the victim will be arrested, detained, or perhaps deported. So identifying and then building trust with victims is critical. And this campaign is designed to reassure victims of trafficking that it is safe to come forward and to show them a future free of violence and exploitation.
By watching out for signs of human trafficking, local organizations and service providers are helping to identify and rescue victims. Given Kachepa was just 11 years old when he was brought to the United States. He was an orphan living in crushing poverty in Zambia when a U.S.-based trafficker promised him an education, free clothes, and the chance to earn money to build schools back home. All by singing in this boys' choir in churches across the U.S. But once here, Given recognized none of it was true, yet he couldn't just walk away.
Just the mind games are the biggest things in the first thing that, you know, if you run away or if you call the police or the INS or the U.S. government, anybody you inform, they're not going to have any interest in you. They're just going to send you back. What good do you have to them?
Members of the Colleyville Baptist Church in Texas began to suspect that something wasn't right with the Zambian choir and came to the boy's rescue. You may come into contact with victims of human trafficking and not know it. So Rescue and Restore urges you to look beneath the surface and pay attention to clues.
There are a number of clues to identify trafficking. Typically, you'll look for the lack of proper documentation, maybe a well-rehearsed story that may be given to me by the trafficker. You'll also look for physical signs of abuse. You might also
Evidence of being controlled is another important clue. Knowing what questions to ask can help uncover victims of trafficking. Questions like, are you being paid? Have you been threatened? Where do you eat and sleep? And can you leave your job if you want to?
I was not free to move in and out the factory ground as I wish. I was forced to live in a very unclean housing and to eat ugly food.
Asking the right questions helped free Hao Trinh from the unthinkable abuse she suffered as a garment worker.
They don't have food for us to eat. And in a small room with so many people inside, we have no electric fan and too hot in the daytime.
If you've met someone like Hao, Sarah, Esmeralda, or Given, who you think might be enslaved, take action. You may be the only outsider with a chance to speak to the victim. Contact the police if you suspect the victim is in imminent danger. Either way, call the National Human Trafficking Resource Center to activate local on-the-ground support for the victim. The Resource Center is available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, with operators who can immediately connect victims to community groups that can help. The HHS Rescue and Restore campaign has set up a safety net of organizations across the country to help identify, rescue, and provide social services to trafficking victims. It's a modern-day underground railroad to help victims on the road to freedom.
The Rescue and Restore program is designed to assist victims in rebuilding their lives. Our national network of social service providers stands ready to provide victims with necessary services in their time of need. We are doing everything we can to help victims regain their dignity and become self-sufficient. Our goal is to see victims of human trafficking become survivors.
Trafficking victims, whether they are foreign-born or U.S. citizens, are eligible for benefits and services such as shelter, food, medical care, counseling, language assistance, job training, and education.
We help these survivors with the paperwork that they need to get the benefits and services that they're entitled to. We help them get past the language barriers they're facing. We help them do job training and ultimately secure the jobs they're looking for. We're going to try to get them help with documentation, ultimately help them apply for a T visa, which will give them permission to stay in the country for a certain period of time.
The HHS Rescue and Restore campaign provides a wide range of resources, lighting the way for organizations helping to lead victims out of the darkness of modern-day slavery. Both Esmeralda and Gibbon's road to freedom began with the help of people they barely knew. With Esmeralda, a neighbor came to her rescue. It's been a long and sometimes painful recovery process. But with the help of caseworkers and foster families, both have persevered. Today, they are adapting well to living free in America, doing well in school, enjoying the mall, singing for the joy of it. You can play a crucial role in helping the thousands of human trafficking victims. Become a partner by joining.
I just wanted you to see the words of Trafficker once he was convicted. And this tells the whole story. So we're going to
open it up for questions.
Sobering, but I'm sure some of you have reactions, questions, so we have maybe about 15, 20 minutes. So if you would just give me your question, I'll repeat it in the microphone so that everyone can hear it, and then Sister will answer it using her microphone. Yes?
Rather than organizations, what can we do to help human
trafficking victims recover rather than to these organizations?
What can be done to help the victims recover?
Victims are going to need professional help. Right now in Green Bay, we have a young man and a young woman, a husband and a wife, who have started I Heart World, and we have a safe house. And I think the safe house is really the only place that we have. And there are some things in the Fox Valley. Five Stones can also give you some heads up. But they need to have, I know, I Heart World. We will give every young woman ages 18 to 25 will be given a whole year of rehabilitation. And Lutheran Social Services in Green Bay is taking care of the younger children, the children from 7 to 17. But other things that you can do, you know, there are so many things on the internet that you can look up. And also, the reason why I wanted you to have those red flags was if you see something, I would, you know, they say call the hotline, but on the bottom of my card, I have call 911, because 911 is, those are your policemen right here in town. And call them, and even if maybe it's not human sex trafficking, they would be most grateful to hear from anybody. Or if you know of somebody, you know, in your neighborhood who, it just seems like something's wrong, call 911 and say you want to talk to a policeman because you think that there is some human sex trafficking going on. And they will never say, oh, stop bothering us. I mean, even if it is something else, rather be wrong about it than not to have it put out there. Thank you for asking.
Thank you. Another question, comment?
Is it Galway Bay?
Okay. So you just discussed some of the places that we can devote resources in order to like rehabilitate people. And obviously there's a lot of aspects of this issue where we could be devoting our resources. But I guess I'm trying to find out like what's the most, where should we be devoting our resources the most? Like what's the most efficient way? Because I know you guys are doing a lot of awareness promoting, but like should we be devoting resources there? Should we be doing to rehabilitation? Like how do we get people to stop paying for sex? Like, you know, like what's the ultimate solution to this problem?
Where should our resources be focused in order to get to the ultimate solution of the problem?
First of all, in your own families. You know, if you have a brother or a dad who is objectifying women, you know, saying mean things, treating them terribly, just put your foot down and say, you can't do that anymore. We are not the kind of family that this should be happening in. And, you know, I think you people are all good Christians, I'm sure.
Not necessarily. They're good people. They're good people.
Okay. Anyway, whoever your God is, you can talk to your God and say, please help us. And just the fact that you people came here today, the first and most important thing is to gain an awareness about what this problem really is. And you have done that already. But there are so many places where you can put human trafficking in and look up things on the internet. They have hundreds and hundreds of places. I'm not, you know, if you're around where there is a safe house and you hear that there is such a thing as a safe house, if you go to the internet and put in iHeartWorld, right now we don't have the house yet, we will have it by next spring. And we are asking for packages of little gifts to give to the girls or the victims that the police are bringing to us. And I know Five Stones is doing some of this same kind of work. Unfortunately, we don't have that many safe houses in the state of Wisconsin, or in the United States for that matter. So, you know, if somebody's coming around saying we need a safe house and we can't afford it, but we need the house in order to rehabilitate these people, if you know of somebody who has a house, somebody in Green Bay gave us a house, and we are so grateful because we keep having fundraising, but that doesn't help because, I mean, it doesn't, yes, it helps, but it doesn't completely take care of our needs.
Carrie?
I guess I'm wanting to know, when I think of the word human trafficking, I think of people being stolen. So in terms of the incidents in Wisconsin, are most victims stolen away from their families, or are they like dropped back off at?
The question is, are people stolen away from their homes or work or school? In what way are they stolen, and is that what's going on in Wisconsin?
Thank you for that question, which is very important, because many of our victims are living at home, but they are ashamed to tell their parents what they're into, because some guy at school has taken control of them. And if you buy one of my DVDs, there are three people who talk. I talk for about 20 minutes, and then there is a survivor who talks for 40 minutes, I think. And she tells, she was at home. She lived in Wauwatosa, very rich family. Her uncle was a judge, and she was not able to tell anybody because she was too ashamed. And so, you know, and if you get that feeling like there's somebody that I happen to know that is very introverted, doesn't like to talk, doesn't have friends, you know, you can go and become a friend.
Sometimes they can be foster children or runaways.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And it's control, whether, and Antigo, I've heard in Antigo, I've heard up in Hayward, that children just disappeared. And I believe that there are children around here too. You know, this DVD talked about in other countries, but we also have the problem here. And this is primarily our problem here in Wisconsin, that most of these kids, most of these young women, are our own people. Maybe they come from Michigan or from Minneapolis, but primarily they are our own.
Sister, you've spoken quite a bit about the victims and the tragedy that they suffer. But in our system, there's only a supply if there's a demand. And when you put the list on your PowerPoint of who the buyers are, they are very respectable people in our community.
Absolutely.
They are not undocumented aliens coming to kill us from other countries. They're not radical terrorists. These are the respectable leaders in our community. Now, these people are invisible, and from what you said in your talk, they get off with maybe a slap on the wrist. What can be done about them? Because if they are making the demand, then the vulnerable people in our community are always going to be manipulated by the pimps. How can you get at the person who is the respectable CEO, teacher, clergy person, business person, who is buying these people?
You know, and there's where put your antennae up. And I do that, right, Kathy? Whenever we go someplace, my antennae are stuck up there. And if I see something among some of these good, so-called good people, I will dig into it. And I will tell a police officer. Oh, yes. In Appleton, thank you, Kat. In Appleton, there is a place that is called a John School, and there is where the buyers of sex, once they are caught now, they are fined. And, you know, we should go to our legislators and demand stiffer fines. I know that some people wanted to put the buyers of sex, their pictures in the local paper or on a milk carton or whatever. And we're so reluctant to do that. Oh, you know what? Their kids in school are going to be bullied because their daddy is a bad man. Well, Most of the buyers of sex also do not want their wives to know. Please, please, please. Well, if they had bigger fines, and now the buyers of sex in the Fox Valley must go to school for a whole day. They pay $250 to go and listen to people telling them what they have done so wrong. And they watch films. And I'm told by the Five Stones group that most of those men leave sobbing with tears in their eyes because they say, I never realized what I was doing. I was just having a good time. And we do have to get at them. Because once we can rid ourselves of buyers, then the pimps will have no reason to coerce somebody because they will have no place to sell them.
Other questions, comments? We have a few more minutes. Yes, Kath?
Do you want to mention about what all of us can do right now, a little thing we can do, about going into the stores and asking to have some of the revealing provocative magazines?
Yes.
Away or covered up or something.
What can we do right now when we go into stores and we see questionable material that might be soliciting people to this kind of activity?
Most of your grocery stores have Cosmopolitan. When I was a teenager, Cosmopolitan was a good magazine. I looked through it, but it is something now that is god-awful. And the objectification of women. And I went, Pick and Save just came into Green Bay a few months ago. And we went there and bought our groceries. And it was on the day that they had the grand opening. And I went up to somebody who looked like she was maybe somebody in charge, and I said, "You know what? Are you in charge? I'd just like to tell you how I feel about coming here and having such a wonderful grocery store. Oh, and she was all ears, and she wanted to hear what I had to say. And then I said, you know, I'm so glad. Your store is so wonderful. But I would just ask you one thing. Why do you have Cosmopolitan on all of your checkout places? Well, then she was not too happy. I said, would you please get rid of them? And she said, well, they come with everything else. There's not much we can do. So some of our high school kids have been going in, and Sister Kathy does this too. Whenever we come up and we see it, we take the Cosmopolitan ones and turn them around backwards or upside down or something. No, don't turn them upside down, because people will think, oh, that's upside down. I need to write it up. So turn them backwards so that people are not tempted to buy them.
Other questions, comments? Anything else you'd like to know about the trafficking?
Oh, I have something. She's my ears and eyes too. Tattoos. Folks, if you, well, tattooing is the in thing today, huh? How many of you have a tattoo? Ah, see, sure. And that's the thing. That's the thing that's happening. However, what pimps do is that they tattoo their victims by putting their initial, right, on the back of their neck. And we were in a truck stop, and I said to Kathy, who, our lady who is our waitress, is being trafficked. And sure enough, when she left, she never looked us in the face, she never smiled, and she never talked. She just came to get our what we wanted to eat, and she was off. And when she came back, and she put mine down like this, right on her wrist was a big tattoo saying Daddy with chains around it. Well, I knew that that was not her daddy's, her own father's. But pimps also demand that their victims call them Daddy. And so if you see tattoos that are questionable, go right up to the person and say, hey, I noticed you have a tattoo. I have one too. See, here's mine. Well, if you have one. Don't just go out and get them. But ask her what they're all about. And if she gets very nervous, then you call 911 and say, hey, there's this woman and she has, or this young girl, and she has a tattoo. And it looks like it's a tattoo from a pimp, from a trafficker. And again, maybe you're wrong, but very probably you're right.
Well, we want to thank you all for coming. We want to thank Sister Celine for sharing with us such very important information that we have to consider and when we can act on. Thank you very much, Sister. The next event that the Center will sponsor is in 2 weeks on Monday, February 20th. We will have a scholar here from the University of Oklahoma, Michael Crispin, and Professor Schatzinger will introduce him, and they will both talk about the future of our current Congress under the new administration in Washington. So we hope you can come to that event on February 20th.
And if you would like to buy one of the